Professor John Traphagan from the University of Texas at Austin, in the Department of Religious Studies. And he'll be delivering a talk followed by sort of response from Ryoko Nishijima from here at UCLA Anthropology. And she'll get us started with our discussion for the second session. So, John?
Well, thank you, Ted, for inviting me here, and thank you, Monico, and this was certainly a very interesting start to the day this morning with Ellen's talk. I'm going to talk today about some research I've been doing on entrepreneurs in Iwate, and also a little bit about return migration, and because it's very tied into what's going on with the people that I'm actually talking about. Can we maybe switch at least the front lights off so it's a little easier to see this? Yeah, that looks good. So I want to talk about the cases of two return migrants who are entrepreneurs in Iwate. And I want to begin by saying everything I have to say today is very preliminary. I actually have not spent a huge amount of time going through the data that I have yet. I've looked at several of the different interviews that I've done and that sort of thing, but this was a little bit last minute. I got asked to do this, and I thought, well, this would be a good thing to talk about because it kind of fits in. So I don't know how deep this is going to be, but at least it'll maybe be interesting to me, so that's good. So I've been doing this project for a while, and I'm interested in what kinds of entrepreneurial activities are going on. I think a lot of times when we think about Tōhoku, and later on I'll come back to this because I don't know what Tōhoku is, but anyway, when we talk about that, we don't think about a place with vibrant business activity and this sort of thing. We think about a place with farms and old people and not enough people and this kind of thing. And those images are not untrue, but they tend to obfuscate the complexity of what actually is going on in Tōhoku. So I've been interested in, you know, what people are doing and why. And of course, if you think about Tōhoku, you need to think about the bullet train because that's central mode of transportation that ties it to Tokyo and to the rest of the world. You might also think about agricultural production like this. And no, this is not massive onion production for an international market. It's local garden for a local restaurant that produces much of its own produce, like onions and this sort of thing. So you get very, very fresh food when you eat there, and I'll come back to that in a minute. I'm going to think a little bit about Tōhoku as a region, mostly to indicate how totally confused I am by the topic of this workshop. So you'll just see my confusion. All right, so I study this little town called Kanegasaki, and it's the yellow one there. And it's about 2 hours and 45 minutes by bullet train to get to the nearest station. And then it takes another 15 or 20 minutes to drive from the station to Kanegasaki. This is a small town. It's about 16,000 people. The eastern part of the town is comparatively densely packed. Very quickly, when you move out of the eastern towards the west, you hit open plains with rice fields. That's what it is. And eventually, you hit mountains to the west. It is an agricultural community, and certainly in many ways. They produce rice. It's an area that has a large number of dairy farms, which is a little bit different from what you typically get in Japan. You think of dairy more in Hokkaido, but this particular group of dairy farmers were, when they were repatriated, they had been in Manchuria. When they were repatriated, they got settled here in Kanegasaki. So actually, you have a group of farm families that have been together since, at least the 1930s in Manchuria. That are producing dairy. Now, the dairy farms are undergoing a fair amount of stress right now, and some of them are shutting down, and I'll come back to that in a few minutes. They make, you know, grow apples, but there's manufacturing there, at least a little bit. And there are small businesses. A lot of the small businesses are in one way or another tied to agricultural production. And there's actually an agricultural college located in the town, a two-year college that trains people to work on farms in that area in general. The two towns next to it, surrounding it, one below, the kind of huge one there is called Oshu, and the one above it is called Kitakami. And Oshu is a new town. It's not an old town. It's old in a way, but you've got Kitakami with about 93,000 people and then Oshu with about 121,000 people. And it's a product of merging that's gone on in the last 10 years. So Oshu didn't exist 15 years ago. And there are five municipalities that came together. This guy in the picture here was the mayor of Kanegasaki, and he resisted and has resisted for a long time, and the town has resisted gappe or amalgamation with its neighbors. Both Kitakami and Oshu want Kanegasaki. And if you just showed up there, you'd kind of think, why? Well, because nestled into the mountains is a very large industrial park. And that industrial park is attractive because it provides income, jobs, taxing, and I'll come back to it in a minute and talk to you a little bit more about it. I thought it would be interesting just to kind of give you a sense of, you know, what it used to be like. These pictures were provided by my advisor at the University of Pittsburgh, Keith Brown. These are photos that he took in 1962 and then more recently. And one of the things you can see is obviously the difference in the amount of labor required to do things like rice planting. You know, in the past you had a row of people, now you got, you know, two people on a rice planting machine. Really much less labor is involved in taking care of rice than there used to be. In fact, in this part of Japan, as I think most parts of Japan, the vast majority of people who actually do rice farming are the elderly. Middle-aged people don't spend much time on this. They're busy in other kinds of jobs. And this gives you a little idea of how harvesting has changed. You know, in the past, they dried rice on these posts. And actually, you can still see this. This isn't completely gone. I know I've actually done that myself, so it still gets done. But now they use rice combines, and they can basically do the whole operation very quickly. Now, these pieces of equipment are very expensive, and that presents other kinds of problems for the farmers who work in this area. But again, it requires a lot less labor to do this, which is a good thing because their population is declining in many areas throughout this part of Japan. So what's the economic situation like? Well, it's like these two pictures. The center of Kanegasaki is characterized by empty storefronts, one after another. As you walk down the street, you see where there was a shop of some kind, and it's gone. People used to live above or behind the shop. Some of those places still have people living in them. Some of them are empty. And interestingly enough, the empty store shop fronts in the downtown area have actually been there for quite some time because, I don't know, 30 years ago, they built a bypass route that went around the center of Kanegasaki, and that pulled the businesses out, and they wound up on, a lot of businesses wound up growing on along the bypass because it's easily accessible by car. This is one of those businesses here in the bottom. They are now dying. In the past few years, this used to be a game arcade. It's closed. When I was there last summer, a car dealership that had been there ever since I went there in the late 80s was gone. And this is really a pretty typical thing that you see in this area. The stores are, you know, going out of business. It's difficult to access stores downtown. There's nowhere to park, and that's contributed to that. But then even along these places with large parking lots, you're not seeing that many people. Now, this picture is a little bit misleading. While this has gone out of business, there is another part of the strip mall that has a large grocery store that is doing fine. So it's not like everything's just going out of business, but in the past, the whole strip mall was full, and it's losing stores. It's not a care culture, it's a car culture. You really have to drive around if you're there. Most people, most families have multiple cars, and these are examples. This is a shopping mall in the neighboring town. And that's usually, nowadays, if you're living in Kanagasaki, that's where you're going to go. You have to go to Oshu or Kitakami in order to do any significant shopping because there isn't much left in Kanagasaki. There is one area on the far north border of Kanagasaki that has a large shopping mall. If any of you know Aeon, you see them all over. It has one of those, and it's got, you know, lots of stuff there. So, but that's actually right on the border of Kitakami. So it's servicing both areas, and you can't get there unless you have a car. I mean, there's just no way to do any shopping unless you have a car. So the area is experiencing, well, the population is interestingly relatively stable in Kanagasaki, although when you go to a lot of other areas right nearby, you're seeing decline. The reason it's stable there is largely because of the industrial complex that exists in the town. That has allowed them to hold on. But despite that stability, there's plenty of evidence that the decline is on the way. This house here, when I was doing my dissertation field work in the 1990s, that house was occupied by a woman who was in her 80s at the time. She died, and it has never been occupied since. This is very, very typical. This past summer, in the little hamlet where I've spent a lot of time doing research, I did a very loose survey, just kind of walking around to get a sense of how many empty houses there are. And there are, when I was doing my work in the 90s, there were 125 or so households in that little hamlet. I guessed, and again, this is not terribly scientific, but I think it's relatively accurate, that between 30 and 40% of the houses are empty. So a third of this little village is gone, mostly through people dying. I was stunned. I lived right behind this house, and almost every house around the house I lived in was shuttered and empty. And they were all full. They all had families, people living in them. There were a couple still left. But so we're seeing some, you know, rather stunning examples of population decline beginning to show up in this area. Schools are not able to run at capacity. This, I can't walk with this thing, can I? Oh, yes, I can. All right. So this is actually a picture of the elementary school that my daughter has gone to. That's my daughter there. And that school was designed for 242 kids in sixth grades. And it reached a low a few years ago of 52 in sixth grades. It's actually a little higher right now. They had combined 9 in first and second grade a few years ago, which of course tells you that in the long run things are not going to be very good. This is not unique to this area. Last summer I was in Niigata in a village up in the mountains, and there was an elementary school that had been designed for 150 students, a relatively new building, you know, maybe built 20, 25 years ago. It had 9 students across 6 grades, and 3 of them were transplants from another part of town who weren't doing well in a larger school, so they thought it would make sense to put them in this very small environment. So there were actually more teachers than students in the school because of laws that limit how many teachers they can have. So one of the things about Kanagasaki, like Iwate in many ways, is it's a place to leave. The reason that this is happening is because young people move out. It is often perceived as a place with very limited opportunity. It's perceived as a place that's backwards in terms of being very traditional, in that word being used in a not a positive way. And when you look at the history here, you can see this is shows you what out-migration in Tōhoku or parts of Tōhoku has been like since the 1950s. Now, it was pretty extreme back in the early 60s, and it's had moments where there were people moving in. That big dip over there, of course, is 2011, and that's caused by Fukushima Prefecture. But Iwate, the dotted line, has basically, since 1955, never really been in the positive. It's always losing a certain amount of its population. So now, this is net, so you get, you know, overall, the population is declining in this situation. And so it's a place that people want to get away from. And that's, you know, very common sentiment among particularly young people. And if you think about it, I mean, well, you know, Tokyo's a more exciting place. And people want to go there, and they want to get an education there, and they want to have a career there. And I'm not going to go into all of this right now because I don't have time today. But there are some interesting patterns underneath this. There's a pattern called a U-turn in which people go into Tokyo, they work there, and then they retire and they come back. And so this is actually creating a whole host of other problems because you wind up with two-generation households where the young generation is in their 60s experiencing physical problems themselves, and they can't handle 90-plus-year-old parents, you know, getting them in and out of a bath or something like that. So that's created a variety of other issues. So I painted a bleak picture. It's dying. They're losing their population. The schools don't have enough kids. Businesses are dropping off. And yet, there's a whole lot of interesting economic innovation going on at the same time. There are a variety of local entrepreneurs starting various kinds of small businesses. This one, well, actually, a lot of these are connected with local kind of products and things. This one isn't. This is a high-end clothing manufacturing company in Oshu. It's not in Kanagasaki. And it supplies custom order clothes for people who live in Tokyo or for high-end stores in Tokyo. So if you go in and, you know, want to buy a really expensive dress or suit, it may have been made here. And this is owned by a woman who's lived in Oshu her entire life, and she's currently in her 80s. This business has been around quite some time, actually. She's been at this for a long time. This was also the site taking this picture of one of those little embarrassing moments you have in the field when you say something you wish you hadn't said. And we're standing in the middle of this place with all these women working. And I said, wow, it must get really hot in here in the summer. And I thought, I just called her business a sweatshop. And it, you know, as soon as it came out of my mouth, I was actually just sort of objectively trying to comment on the fact that it's does get hot. But actually, she corrected me quickly and pointed out, it's air conditioned. It doesn't get hot in there. She takes good care of her employees. So, and she employs quite a few local women. There's a lot of interest in promoting local products. Mr. Asparagus here is standing next to my daughter at a festival in Kanagasaki. And actually, that's the city hall right behind it, behind the whole thing. They promote dairy products, of course, because they have a lot of dairy farms, and they promote asparagus a lot. Anyone here ever had asparagus-flavored ice cream? You can get it here. It's actually not bad. I was really surprised. It tastes pretty good. I can also get tomato-flavored ice cream there and a few other. It's a tomato sorbet, actually. But I fully expected asparagus to be gross, and it wasn't. So some of these municipalities will set up offices in Tokyo to try to promote local agriculture. Going back to this issue of Fukushima, this has been a problem because people in other parts of Japan have had an image that everything's irradiated, so you shouldn't eat it. And I know not too long after the disaster happened, there were some of these local stores selling products from Tōhoku were doing things like setting up a Geiger counter next to produce from Tōhoku, trying to show people, no, it's okay, you can eat this. And so you look at the disaster, and of course, it was most horrific on the coast, but it has affected the entire area in terms of agricultural production, at least, because of this image of what the nuclear power plant is doing to agricultural production in that area. There's been issues with milk and other things that have come up. And the other thing is they're deeply involved in international manufacturing. The large industrial park I was talking about has a pharmaceutical company. It had a, I don't know if it's Fujitsu anymore, but there was a semiconductor production facility there and a Toyota factory. If you drive a Prius C or a Lexus, it may very well have been made in Kanagasaki. They make them for the export market. They're left-hand drive. Is it left? I always get confused. Yeah, we sit on the left, right, when we get in the car. Yeah, I get confused. So I drive all the time over there, and it's people often ask me, you know, how do you get in a car and drive in Japan? And I tell them, well, the first thing I do is I wind up on the wrong side of the road, usually about 10 minutes after I get behind the wheel. And then eventually it straightens out. But which scares the locals quite a bit when I'm coming. So this is a huge employer, right? This is stable work. It's good work, people working on the production line. There are a lot of management people that come in, and this is actually, I think, why the population has remained relatively stable in recent years. The managers don't come from that area. They come from elsewhere. Toyota brings them in. And that keeps a kind of flow of people coming in and out of Kanagasaki. If this wasn't here, then the population would be declining precipitously right now. I think this is really the reason, and the other things that are in the same industrial park, the reason that it isn't declining right now. All right, so I want to turn to two cases of Kanagasaki entrepreneurs. And read the t-shirt on that young boy's body there. This is the zoo in Morioka, and I put this up there. I was just looking for pictures, and I thought, you know, this really points out how connected into the rest of the world people are in rural, backwards Tōhoku. Of course, now, he got the t-shirt when he was visiting us in Austin, but the fact is people do that all the time there. They travel all over the place, and that's my daughter holding the, what is it that she's holding? A goat, I guess, yeah. I thought it was a cat for a minute, but that's a big cat. So, you know, people travel around. They have experience in lots of other parts of the world, and so they are very tied into international flows and things. All right, so I want to begin talking about a pizza parlor. And, you know, pizza is very popular in Japan these days. And so that is a pizza parlor on top. It's not usually what you think of, is it? The pizza parlor is, it's not just pizza, it's a restaurant that was made out of an old samurai house that's located in the center of Jōnai, which is the village that I was talking about that I've spent a lot of time doing research. It's part of the designation of the hamlet as a historical district. And what they've been trying to do is find ways to restore these old houses and bring in tourism. And this is it's working. This is a busload of people from somewhere else in Iwate, I think, who are there for the day to walk around, and they get guided tours by the locals. And they may wind up stopping at this little restaurant that serves pizza, but it also serves a variety of local or perceived local dishes, like one called suiton. Anyone here ever had suiton? It's really good. I'll show you a picture of it. Well, actually, I'll show you a picture of it right now. It's the one on the right. This is, I eat lunch there almost every day when I'm there. And it's made with like a kind of noodle-y sort of thing, but they're not thin, long noodles. They're like chunks of noodles. And at one time, as I've been told, it was poverty food in that area. But now it's become kind of a local delicacy. And there are quite a few restaurants that are now specializing in their version of suiton. And so I unfortunately don't, I realized when I started putting this together, I never took a picture of the pizza. So I don't have a picture of the pizza, despite the fact that my daughter has dragged me there numerous times to eat the pizza. I never bothered to take a picture. So you'll just have to imagine. If you can imagine what pizza looks like, that's it. So Hiroshi is the owner of this place, and I've talked to him several times. He's 38 years old right now. He's the eldest son. He's married, and he has two children. And his wife and two children live in Hokkaido. They don't live with him in Kanagasaki. So he has three siblings. After high school, he moved to Sapporo, and he had no plan to return to take on responsibilities as head of the household. His parents weren't terribly concerned about this. They weren't pressuring him or anything. And they told him, you know, no, go off and have your life. We're fine here. Everything's cool. So he did that. And he became a chef. And he worked in a fairly large restaurant that unfortunately went bankrupt. And this forced him to think about what he was going to do with his life. And what he decided to do was to return to Kanagasaki to start a restaurant. And his wife said, are you kidding? I don't want to live in a place like that. And she opposed. But he did it anyway. So they all moved to Kanagasaki. And then after a couple years, wife and the kids returned because she hated it. And so now they live apart. It should be Hiroshi, sorry, I should have changed that. So he meets his family three times a year. He actually, in our conversation about this, he broke down in tears talking about how much he misses his family. This is very hard for him. At the same time, he feels like it's something he needs to do. He needs to have a business. He wants to do this. And so he's somehow managing. He does keep up a business relationship with his father-in-law, from whom he buys seafood because his father-in-law is a fisherman. So that's maintains a connection there. But the fact is, this is a very difficult situation for him because on the one hand, he's doing what he wants to do with his own life, but he's doing it apart from his wife and children, and that's not happy. Now, this kind of thing involves risk. If you're going to do entrepreneurial activity, there's risk. But one of the things, one of the reasons he wanted to open a store here was because it reduced that risk dramatically. And the reason it did was because he used his parents' old house. He got funds to restore the house so that it would meet the requirements for being in this historical district. And he also used money from his parents' retirement. He didn't take out any loans or anything like that. And that allowed him to restore it. And as you can see, this is the inside. It's lovely inside. I mean, it's really beautiful the way they've done the restoration. His parents provide some of the labor. His mother is a waitress. And his father tends the garden. There's a beautiful garden outside. And also he repairs a lot of things that, you know, break, including machinery in the kitchen. And then he has a couple of part-time employees that also are pretty deeply involved in the business. And one of the things that he hoped was that the restaurant would attract tourists to this historical district. And that is in fact what it has done. The sales are good. Things are going pretty well for him. And he actually, in the long run, what he wants to do is open up another one of the same style in Hokkaido so that he can move back and be with his family. That's his long-term goal. Now, he's well aware that that may not actually ever happen, that this may be the best that he can actually do. But that's what he'd like to do. So I asked him, why do you do this? And he said, well, my business is for living. You know, I do it so that I can make a living. I sustain my life with what I like to do. He was very, very strong about the importance of doing something he liked. I don't work for becoming rich or expanding my business. My objective of having this restaurant is making my customers happy through what I want to do, which he meant, you know, what he's good at doing. In addition, he said, I want to contribute to the development of tourism in Kanagasaki. This is very interesting how he situated this into the broader framework of the community and what's going on in this historical district. I like cooking, so I liked my previous job as well. However, the reason why I opened my own restaurant rather than being employed by someone, like his old job, is that I want to develop and manage the restaurant on the basis of my original idea and style. So he's interested in doing his own thing. Now, I'm going to come back to this in a few minutes and kind of unpack a little bit of what he's saying. But before we do that, I want to talk about a gelato and cheese shop. Now, if you thought the pizza shop was weird, this is really weird. This is a gelato and cheese shop in Kanagasaki, and this is the street it's on. It's a good 12 kilometers from the center of town, absolutely in the middle of nowhere. There is nothing around it but dairy farms. This is across the street. That's hay for cows. And this is really popular. It's so popular that the owner has had to expand her parking area because she was clogging up the streets, particularly in the summer, with cars everywhere. They park, they fill up parts of this field across the street because it is just a nonstop flow of traffic, particularly in the warmer months. Above this, she has a bed and breakfast. And actually, the apartment above is where I stay when I'm in that part of Japan. So I have a pretty good feel for what this place is like. She produces both ice cream and cheese. Now, it's nice that it's kind of on the way to an onsen, to a hot spring. And it's a really nice hot spring. She actually has some of her gelato is at the hot spring in cups that, you know, are packaged. And she attracts customers who are on their way to or from the hot spring. So that's helped with her business. But they literally do come by the busloads. And I thought I would show you a little... Oh, don't do that. Oh, it's not connected to the... Hold on one second. Let me just connect my internet there. And we'll go there.
Let me just get the...
Oh, yeah.
Just turning it down a bit in case, just so we don't get blasted.
Well, I don't think it's hooked up anyway for sound.
It should be.
Is it?
But here, let's go to system preferences. Okay. Just a moment. This invariably happens.
Yeah, it's working.
Oh, you have it.
Yeah, well, yeah, but the thing is, it's not hooked
right,
sound,
right.
Sir. So the sound doesn't matter, actually, that
okay.
much. All right. So you can hear the music in the background. So that's the owner. I can't, if I make it much bigger, it pixelates, so it's no good. That's the inside of the shop. It's really nice. There's a big window just to the right of that. And one summer while I was there, one of her customers inadvertently stepped on the accelerator instead of the brake and literally drove her car right through the window into the middle of the store. Glass went all over the place and, yeah. That looks pretty appetizing, doesn't it? It's really good gelato, I have to tell you. It's fabulous. This YouTube thing is quite interesting. Whoops. Put that back. Oh, well. She didn't know it was up. And I actually was doing a Google search one day, and I just typed in the name of her store and found it. She was furious because the person who did it never told her that he put it up there. And so she was quite surprised by it.
Hmm? Did she commission him to do it?
No. He was just taking pictures.
Whoa.
Yeah. She's not terribly internet savvy, so it didn't occur to her that that might happen. So this gives you a pretty good idea. There it is sitting among the fields with the farm behind it.
What's the mountain in the background?
Hmm?
What mountain is
that? Oh, I don't know what it's called. Yeah. I may not even have a name. So that gives you an idea of what this place is like. So, Etsuko, as I'll call her, she's the youngest of three daughters. She's 50 years old. And she actually attended a dressmaking school out of high school She worked for a dressmaking company and then worked for department stores, and actually worked for, I think, a fairly high-end department store at one point doing men's suits and selling men's suits. But then she got tired of life in Tokyo, and she decided she wanted to move back to the countryside, and she attributed this to the beauty of the rural area, slower pace of life, and the fact that she could relax a bit. So she had decided to return to Kanagasaki before deciding to start her own business, but figured, well, I'm going to be there, I got to find something to do. So she was interested in trying to use the dairy farm as a way to try to build a business and as a basis for creating what was initially just going to be a cheese shop. And this had been discussed with her father for several years. They had been kind of chatting back and forth about this. So she went back to Iwate. She started working for a local cheese shop and then went to the Netherlands to learn to make cheese there and brought back her knowledge and started this. Her father supported the business interests. He was actually thrilled with the fact that she was going to carry on the family business, even though if it wasn't exactly in the form of the dairy farm, at least the dairy business. This would be the third generation for this business. And he invested close to 20 million yen in building, getting the equipment that you need. There's a fair amount of machinery you need for making the kind of cheese that she makes. And so, you know, it became a kind of family business. Now, when I asked her about why she did this, she talked about empowerment. She said, I liked my job in Tokyo, but I felt there was a ceiling for working women to get a promotion in the company, especially in a big company. If I want to get a promotion, probably it's better to work for a smaller company, and then, of course, even better to work for yourself. So forming a business is tough, but at the same time, I enjoy it because I can manage my business as I want. Then she said something really I thought was quite interesting. She said, especially for a woman, as women do not think on the basis of statistics or theory, a woman follows her own feeling. This is right or wrong, this is good or bad, this will be going well or not, compared with men. It is comfortable for me to carry out my business with my feeling and with female part-time workers. She employs no men, only women. And women can share the sense or the feeling of what she's trying to do. Now, the interesting thing is that one time when I was there, she was employing a man, and she basically routinely described him as a complete moron, which in fact seemed to be pretty accurate. He did some things that were really stupid that cost quite a bit of money. So she really prefers hiring women. She then said, since my father died, people think I'm Atotsugi, I'm the successor. I still hope my big sister would return to our home and she would manage the family issues. In other words, the things related to the relatives. This is a honke. This is the main household. So they have to deal with branch households that come back for various kinds of things. And, you know, things like taking care of the grave and doing the family rituals and all that. In reality, it is difficult to do both running a business and taking care of family issues at the same time. For instance, in terms of family rituals as the successor or in the main family, I need to think about carefully who I should invite or not. This is time consuming. And despite the fact that she wanted to have a relaxed life, she doesn't have any time. I'll come back to that in a minute. So she wishes somebody else, meaning her older sister, would do this for her. So they're both attracted by Tōhoku. So it's not just a place people leave. It's a place people are attracted to for a variety of reasons. And they're attracted in both of their cases. They talked about the slower pace of life as compared to big cities. Now, again, I don't know what slower pace means. I live up above the cheese shop. She doesn't sleep, ever, as far as I can tell. 3 o'clock in the morning, clang, smash, bang, there's something going on downstairs. I think, actually, in all honesty, she sleeps probably 3 hours a night. It's a lot of work running your own business by yourself, particularly when it's really successful. And she has to make the cheese and the gelato, and you can't not do it because there are going to be customers the next day. So she may be up all night doing that so she can wait on customers the next day. Both also take on their role as family head or head of the household because they're head of the business. And of course, in Hiroshi's case, he's the eldest son, so this is very natural for him. But they actually both do so rather reluctantly. This isn't something that they really want. And this is the downside of returning. So there are good things about coming back, but there are bad things about coming back. And this is one of them. In Etsuko's case, this was somewhat more intense because when she first came back, you know, she's not married. And instantly, all sorts of people were trying to set her up with someone to get married. And it really irritated her because she has no interest at all in getting married. None. And so that actually was quite annoying at first. They both experienced blockage in their work. They couldn't do what they wanted to do. Etsuko couldn't rise to the level that she wanted to in Tokyo. And Hiroshi wants control of his own business. He wants to do his own thing. She does that as well. So control is really central for both of them. Etsuko sees her business as allowing her to be herself as a woman in many ways. She's able to express her femininity and her ideas through the business. Satisfaction in life is very important to both of them. Neither of them are very interested in getting rich. I've asked them both many times about that, and that just isn't really part of the calculus. You know, Etsuko will joke sometime about, you know, maybe she'll get rich off of this, but that really isn't a motivating feature for her. And I think, interestingly, for Etsuko, there is this kind of gendered nature to her business. She's consciously running it as a woman and consciously employing women in the business because that's a way to reflect her vision of what her business is. And then both of them have these kind of interests in the community. They want to contribute to the community as a whole. Hiroshi is living in a tourist area, but Etsuko is also along the route of a tourist area. It's a little bit off. You can't see it on the main road to the onsen, but there's a sign, and people know. They know it's there, and so they make a detour to go there. So I think what you wind up with is a very kind of complicated situation going on in Kanegasaki. You've got decline. The rural environment provides, you know, it is experiencing decline. You have all these empty houses and businesses, but at the same time it provides possibilities and opportunities that people are, you know, some people are interested in pursuing. For Etsuko, this allows her to pursue interests that really would have been limited in part due to her being a woman in a larger company in the city. And she can leave some of the traditional aspects, whatever traditional means, behind in terms of the business life that she experienced by running her own business in Iwate. And it's all hers. Both struggle with traditional patterns, perceptions about traditional patterns of family, or at least expectations about their role as successors. And then this is exacerbated a bit in Etsuko's case because she is unmarried. So there's out-migration, clearly, lots of it. But then there are people going there to pursue dreams, to pursue opportunities that they see that exist. And the fact is the opportunities are there. Now, there is a kind of a point that one has to be careful with this. The opportunities are there now. But given what the implications are for the population in the future, it's difficult to say how long they will be there. If you go to the Japanese government, you know, various statistical websites, and you look at what the projections are for the Japanese population. There are, what, about 126 million Japanese now. By 2110, the estimate is there'll be about 48 million, if nothing changes. So if that's the case, how long these opportunities are going to be there is a very open question, and how long people will be able to do these things. And I know another woman who runs a pharmacy, and also has expanded into several kinds of businesses that are for helping the elderly. And, you know, her comment has been, well, business is booming right now, but it's not going to be 15 years from now because they're all going to die. And so there's a short-term opportunity, at least in that business, that isn't going to last. So I thought about all this to get ready for this thing, and then I thought, so what does any of this have to say about Tōhoku? And I don't know. I have no idea. I'm lost. But what I did think is that, you know, as an ethnographer who spent the last 20 years or so going to Kanegasaki and irritating the locals, I've learned a whole lot about Kanegasaki, and I've learned a fair amount about its neighbors. I know a fair amount about Iwate, I think. I don't know anything about Tōhoku. I realized as I thought about it, I never talk about Tōhoku when I'm with people. I talk about Kanagasaki. Maybe I talk about Iwate a bit, but I really talk about the local context. That's really what our discussions are about. And sometimes people joke about Tōhoku. They'll joke about Zuzuben, and they'll joke about, you know, what Tōhoku is like. But I actually have never asked anybody, it never even occurred to me really, to ask anybody how they conceptualize this thing, Tōhoku, or how they might build their identities in relation to that. So it's not something that has ever popped into my mind while doing field work, which I actually think is kind of telling, that it didn't occur. It may just mean I'm stupid, but it may be that it just isn't that important. I have been told what I should make of it. A scholar, esteemed Japanologist once, who I won't mention his name. Yeah, maybe later I'll tell you. Once when I had met him for something in Tokyo and I was getting ready to leave, he turned and he said, well, you shouldn't be wasting your time up there. The real Japan is here in Tokyo. And then he went on to comment that there aren't any people up there, and urban Japan is the real Japan. And I said, well, you know, there actually are cities in Tōhoku. Sendai has about 1 million people, and I think they're real. So, but that perception is there. People do think that way, including scholars who should know better. Etsuko and Hiroshi have a complex relationship and conceptualization of Kanagasaki. That much I can say. What this has to do with Tōhoku, I'm not sure. But certainly of the local area, it is something that is very complicated. It has a mix of positives and negatives, attractions and repulsions, and all of these things are all jumbled together in their heads all the time. Every time Hiroshi looks at his business and feels good about his business, he thinks about his wife and kids who don't live with him. And, you know, that's tough. And I don't know, you know, I don't honestly know how he manages to balance that, because I couldn't do it. I couldn't make that decision to be away from my family. So I think, you know, one of the real interesting questions is, in what ways do Etsuko and Hiroshi negotiate, contest, and navigate their identities and lives as residents of Kanagasaki, Iwate, Tōhoku, and Japan, as well as entrepreneurs? Because that's part of their identity as well. It's not just somebody from Kanagasaki. They have very strongly formed identities as entrepreneurial people making Kanagasaki a better place through their activities. That's probably far more important to them than being from Tōhoku, or even maybe even being from Kanagasaki. So I think this is what we have to do. So I tried to think a little bit about this, and I really failed. I started thinking about, well, what's Tōhoku? And then I thought, I don't know. So I thought, what's a region? And I looked at a map, and the map told me this is Tōhoku. So now I know. And then it hit me, I come from the Tōhoku of the United States. You know, it's a really interesting thought. New England has a lot in common with Tōhoku. It has 6 states, prefectures. It has significant distinction between the southern and the northern part. You have a large city at the southern part, and it gets very rural towards the north. So I started thinking about what regions are. And New England and Tōhoku are both regions. They're northern, they have these large urban areas. They have smaller urban areas sort of dotted throughout the region. There are distinctive differences between the prefectures and the states. So that raises some questions about what a region is. They're both often perceived as being quite provincial, although when I ran this by my wife, she quickly said, you got to be careful there, because New England also can be perceived as being a center of high culture. And I don't think anywhere in Tōhoku is really seen that way, although it is seen as a center of traditional Japanese culture. So there's a kind of similarity there. They're both perceived nationally in terms of having these kind of common cultural characteristics across them. And there's this idea that, you know, something about being from Tōhoku or being from New England makes one different. I've been told this many times living in Texas, that I am just really strange because of where I come from, and it has to do with being a New Englander. Now, both countries have different regions, so you can't make too much of this. But I just thought it was just a really intriguing idea to see what would happen if you do that. And so then I started thinking, well, why are these regions? Well, I'm from New England, and then wait a minute. So I'm a New Englander. But people in New Hampshire would call me a masshole because they've seen the way I drive. And people from Massachusetts call people in New Hampshire, they call the state Cow Hampshire because it's so rural, that it's an unsophisticated place. Maine is just fundamentally strange. It's different from everything else in the state. It's a vast rural area. The politics of New Hampshire are quite different from the politics of Massachusetts. The tax structure is different. You don't have income tax or sales tax. New Hampshire is more like Texas in that respect than it is like any of the other New England states. You have this northern New England, southern New England kind of divide in which there seem to be a very different things going on in the two areas. Now, I realize this is kind of a spurious comparison, but it raises some interesting questions about the nature of what a region is. And I think these are the questions that if we're going to talk about Tōhoku Gaku, and I'm not convinced we should, but if we are, I think we need to be asking some questions like, what divides Tōhoku? And so I think about when people talk about the town I spent time in, Kanegasaki, they talk about Kanegasaki time. Everyone moves more slowly in Kanegasaki than they do in the neighboring towns. People talk about dialect differences. And I can attest to this. Several years ago, my wife and I went on a driving trip into Aomori, and we got lost. And my wife, who is an Iwate native, gets out of the car and asks directions. It's taking a really long time to get directions. And finally, she comes back to the car and says, wow, why did that take so long? And she said, oh, well, it was a little bit difficult. And I said, well, do you know what the directions? No, I really don't. I said, why? Well, I asked him 5 or 6 times, and I couldn't understand a word he said. And she's from the same region. She's from Tōhoku. So what does that mean to talk about this as a region? I think we need to think about in what ways Tōhoku is contested space. When we were talking about Ellen's work this morning and the issue related to the disaster, the experience inland is very, very different from the experience on the coast. It's also a very extreme experience. It was a real bad thing for them, too. Now, they will tell you their experience was nothing like what happened on the coast, but it still was extremely disruptive. So these are very different things going on in this very small space. To what extent do people from Tōhoku see themselves as Tōhokuites or Iwatonians, I don't know, Akitans or Kanegasakians or Morioukians or whatever? You know, do they really perceive of themselves that way? How do they construct their identities in terms of that place? And what place is it that they choose to construct their identities in terms of? So I think one of the things that we really need to do is work very hard to problematize the space that is referred to as Tōhoku and try to make some sense out of what that means to the people there, if it even means much of anything at all. All right, thank you very much. Do you want to plug in?
No, it's fine. Okay.
I'll take this together.
Okay, I think my clothes that I'm wearing is not suited for a microphone. Maybe I'll hold like this, yeah? Okay. I have no... Here? Is that... Does it work? Okay. Okay. Yeah. So, thank you very much, Dr. Traphagan, for the very interesting talk. And even though you mentioned that it's still very preliminary, I still felt like you had a lot of very interesting ethnographic materials that I had a lot of questions about asking about it further. So a lot of my response would be asking you to elaborate on some of the ethnographic things in the field. And then maybe after that, I would continue to the more kind of maybe conceptual ideas that you touched upon that might help us discuss about the Tōhoku, I guess, in general. So the first question was about the place itself, and I guess it relates also to what you were talking later about the scale of regional boundary and alludes to the questions of whether they identify as from Kanegasaki or Iwatonians or Tohokujin or maybe Japanese. So that would be my first question. When you first said that Kanegasaki is 2 hours and 45 minutes away from Tokyo, I was sort of struck by the, I guess, proximity of this extremely rural-looking place to the huge metropolis in Tokyo. In other words, I can't decide if that three-hour Shinkansen ride is close or far. So I'm curious how the people there perceive their relation to the different levels of urbanity, such as Tokyo or the closer, more prefectural center, Morioka, or even the Aeon Mall in Kitakami. And is that considered the downtown? You mentioned the center of the town is in Kanegasaki is characterized by empty storefronts, but it seems like it's no longer the center of the city. I just wonder the hierarchies of the centers around this, and maybe that can define the boundary of the space that we're talking about. More specifically, I guess, like on what occasions do they go to Tokyo or Morioka, and how often? Is it far or is it expensive? And you said the local farmers often set up offices in Tokyo to promote agricultural products over there. So it seems like for some of them, those urban centers are actually a very mundane part of their everyday lives. And I guess I just want to hear more about how the different cities are positioned in their lives. Okay. The next question is similar to the question on the relation to Tokyo, but I guess more a political one. So how has the central government intervened with the local economy and policy, and how do people respond to that? I know that the government is recently extremely aggressive about this revitalization of the local economy, the chiki kaseika. And the past year, I think, has seen the introduction of furusato tax, which is basically tactics to promote investment into local products and a lot of like U-turn mobility. And I'm wondering if these helping hands of the government are seen as something positive or potentially somewhat patronizing. And on the other hand, many agricultural communities have developed an aversion to the government in opposition to the TPP, and in some, I think in some of the very big areas with big agricultural industries. And this has often been coupled with the anti-nuclear rallies and demonstrations. So I was wondering, have you come across any of these sentiments in the field? Like, how would they position themselves against the central government politically? So that was my next question. Okay, so both cases you presented in the talk were U-turn return migrants, meaning they were originally from there, they went away but came back to their home. But I know that there's also a big phenomenon of I-turners who are, they grew up in the city and then they don't have a home there, but they just return anyways or migrate to the countryside. A lot of youth who, you know, often out of nostalgia and tired of the salaryman lifestyle. And it's the same idea that Etsuko had, it seems, with like, romanticized rural beauty, pursue of slower pace, and could relax in search of the furusato. So I was wondering if you also saw this kind of migration in this area, if this is also a part of the picture of Kanegasaki. Okay. Next question is, it's also a little bit related to the incoming migrants or visitors to the area in a larger sense and more in a global relations. So this is kind of open-ended to foreign residents of the area, visitors, or even workers, tourists, students, wives and husbands, jet teachers, or I don't know, anthropologists somewhere in that dynamics of not intruders, but like people who come to the area. And this question occurred to me when you were talking about the international manufacturing, the big factories. And it seems like where several levels of globalization seems to be at play. So not just the fact that it's manufacturing products for export, and it's a sometimes a very international global company, but also I was wondering if there are a lot of immigrant workers working there, because I know Japan is currently in the middle of a very big debate of immigration policy, and basically the fight between the lack of labor source and the persistent aversion to opening up to foreign workers. And there is the recurring issue of the problematic trainee program where, visas, which basically imports cheap labor from outside. And I see this often happening in big companies, big manufacturing companies and agricultural industry. So the immigrant workers, also like Liba Fair's work here about wives from abroad, Filipino wives, she did her ethnography at the rural Nagano area, and a lack of local wives replaced by someone abroad. And that kind of common practice where something that is not available domestically gets replaced internationally. And I was also wondering if this is something that might happen in Kanegasaki. So that's one side of foreign visitors, and then the polar opposite of foreign visitors. Are there many foreign tourists and backpackers in the area? I'm imagining sort of like expecting the authentic Japan or to the guest houses. How do they add to the local dynamics? Or when Hiroshi talks about tourism, is he mainly thinking about domestic tourists and not very foreign tourists? So that was, okay. About the interviewees, it was I was especially interested in, you mentioned the gender implicated in the ways in which children are expected to take care of their aging parents. Particularly intrigued by what Etsuko said about the kind of division of labor she wishes in taking over the family business. So she would take over the business side, but she would rather have her other sisters working on the family side. And then you said that in both cases, for Hiroshi and Etsuko, the upside of returning to Tōhoku was the business opportunities they had, but the downside was having to take care of parents. And I wonder if Etsuko feels the bigger burden to tend to her parents. And it's also interesting that Hiroshi's wife, who is the yome, the eldest son's wife, who is expected to be the one taking care of the husband's parents, do not live together. So it's very interested in the ethnographic details there and how gender is implicated in their kind of relation and family. Okay, so those were the ethnographic questions quickly about some of the concepts I was thinking. Is that in the end, your talk connects the idea of entrepreneurship and this region in Kanegasaki. And you said the rural environments provide possibilities and opportunities. And I kind of want to dwell on this idea of opportunity and possibility. Generally speaking, when entrepreneurs identify a business chance and start a new company, they do this because they see a kind of untouched open space in the market that they latch on. And it's either lacking or already exists but inferior. So I think that's where entrepreneur, like new business, starts. And making this connection between Tōhoku and entrepreneurship, is this, I don't know, could we say that is it the current emptiness of the area, the kind of vast open space that makes it sort of like a good frontier, so to speak, to, of starting something new from scratch? Restaurants made by remodeling an old house. And I'm not sure if that the remodeled Samurai House restaurant is the same kind of remodeling as the abandoned house you saw by the street. Is like that house could be renovated into a tourist attraction, but could the same thing, same kind of remodeling be done to the abandoned house by the street? So that's the kind of wondering, like lack of business currently means unlimited possibilities to create a new one. And what attracts them to Tōhoku seems like that they see an opportunity that they don't find in Tokyo. And I wonder if this identification of opportunity and possibility is actually a reflection of emptiness and lack. So that's one thing I was thinking. And then, so that was the business side, and then there's the family side of the question. So I also want to look at Tōhoku as the place where the family lives, where homes and parents are. So it become, then becomes where histories and memories of the past is emplaced. In a way, the entrepreneur opportunities are seen as perspective towards the future, but the elderly parents and home is a look back to their past, what has long existed in the place. And this, I believe, is what makes Tōhoku not a pure frontier that merely looks ahead of the future. And I wonder if we can look at the coexistence or perhaps the dilemmas your informants face between the business prospect and the familial past to frame our understanding of Tōhoku as like a mixture of furusato and a future opportunity. Thank you.
I can mark the order of if we want to take two questions again.
Well, shall I try and answer the
five questions?
I think it would be wise to spend a little bit of time on that. I thought your first question is a very interesting one, this idea of how far away is Tokyo? It's not very far away. People constantly hop on the bullet train and go back to Tokyo. And, you know, you can go there for a day, you can go there for overnight. It's you know, conceptually, particularly for, I think, people maybe anything under 70, it's an easy place to get to. I think when you're talking about people who might be in their 80s and 90s, who really probably haven't left much of that area, it may seem like a much more distant place. And I think that's, again, one of the important points is that I don't think you can really generalize about this in many ways. You're going to have, it's going to be far or near or in between, kind of depending upon how the person situates, you know, him or her herself. So I know a couple who go to Italy every year. I mean, that's their thing. They don't have kids. They're about my age, and they love Italy. So every year, that's where they go. But then I know other people who've never really left Nagasaki to speak of in any meaningful way. So I think I think it's a very important question, and I think it's difficult to answer in a broad way. But I think overall, it's easy to get to places like that, and now it's relatively easy to get anywhere. I mean, there's an airport not far away, so, you know, 25 kilometers from where I go, there's an airport that can take you to Tokyo or to other places. So it's very hooked in, and I think that reduces that feeling. You asked about the involvement of the central government. In the cases that I've been dealing with, I haven't really got involved in that too much. I know a couple of areas where there was like a pile of money dumped on a city a fact, in next door in Oshu, there's this where they reconstructed a street to try to make it much more attractive for stores and, you know, to attract young people and that kind of thing. And only one store succeeded. The rest of it more or less failed. And so I have not talked to people about how they feel about that, so I don't really know too much about how they're perceived by the government in relation to those kinds of things. The people I've talked to in Kanagasaki have had some subsidies, but they're local from City Hall generally instead of from the national government. So I can't talk really much about that. The TPP thing is really interesting. Most of the people I've encountered don't like it. I actually was in Niigata last summer for a while and heard a lot of really negatives about it. And there's actually a lot of entrepreneurial agricultural activity going on there, and they're really troubled by this. So I don't, you know, again, this is impressionistic. I haven't studied it formally, but I haven't heard any good about it. Let's put it that way. Then you asked about this sort of issue of this romanticized rural beauty and this kind of thing, and I thought I would kind of correct you on something there. Etsuko has no romanticization of this at all. She grew up there. Have you ever been on a dairy farm? They're not fun places. They stink, they have flies, they require constant work. There was nothing romantic about this at all. This is really, really hard work, and she knew it when she was going into it. But she does like that area as a place to live, because it is pretty, a lot better, I think, than the city. Now, sometimes she really misses the city. She misses her friends in the city. She misses the attraction of the city. So I think in her case, I don't think this is an issue. But I know exactly what you're talking about. I turn, you know, people that have grown up in the city, they usually don't know what they're getting into. And it's this very romanticized image of rural Japan and, you know, growing your own food. I don't know anyone like that. I have not run into that in Kanagasaki. So I've never really talked to anyone about that sort of thing. But it is absolutely there. And probably I just haven't run across it. And I have heard of people who've done that and then failed and moved back to the city. But I guess, let me correct that. I know one person who wanted to work on a dairy farm, and he was going to move there and then move his family. He went ahead and started working on it, and then he just up and left like that. Went back to the city. So it's really hard work. The immigrant worker question is, I think, a really interesting one. I don't know if there's anybody in the Toyota plant or any of those that are immigrants. I kind of doubt it. But I do know that when there was a large dam construction project in Oshu, there were a lot of workers from China there working on that project. And there were actually quite a few issues with them not being treated very well. There was a movement 1 year during the winter to get the blankets, because they didn't have sufficient blankets and things like that. And a lot of locals were trying to collect stuff so that they wouldn't freeze, basically. There are a lot of wives from the Philippines and other places in that area. That's very common. Japanese women often don't want to marry eldest sons who have farms. So that's a very, very, very common. And the tourist question, I think, is really interesting, and it's domestic tourism. I'm the only foreigner I've ever seen, at least in that little hamlet. Now, that doesn't mean there haven't been others that have gone through, but yeah. Now, I do know that it's a gelato shop, that she does occasionally get people from other places. And so, not that are international, but it's not very frequent. Okay, so let me see if I'm getting here. The question, I think, about taking care of the parents, in Etsuko's case, that was, her mother was part of the reason she returned, but it's more taking care of the dead that is a problem. It's all the rituals and everything that go into having to deal with what has to be done that takes a lot of time and that she'd rather have help with. I think if her mother becomes in need of care, one of her sisters will. So I think that expectation is there, because there's no way she can run the business and take care of mom. It's impossible. And so Hiroshi's wife, I've never met her, and so I'm making a guess, but it wouldn't surprise me at all if part of the reason she returns is because she didn't want to be a woman. And she didn't want to deal with her in-laws. I've heard that so many times from women in that area, that when he said that to me, that was the first thing that came to my mind, was that, yeah, she really didn't want to stay there, so because of that. Now, let's see. That was a really interesting idea about the emptiness. And, you know, I think you raised the point that, you know, entrepreneurs target open spaces. And this isn't an open space. It's a place where there is opportunity, because there aren't these kind of, I mean, there aren't gelato shops everywhere there, right? And I think tying in with that is you've got a population that, you know, many people have traveled overseas that live there. They've experienced Tokyo. They want some of that sophisticated lifestyle that they enjoyed when they were wherever they went. And places like gelato shop, the pizza place brings some of this. There's a bakery in the center of town that makes French pastries. And most of it, what I've noticed is most of the little shops that open up are that kind of thing. They provide this sort of, you know, more upscale, sophisticated food or something like that, that's, you know, gives a kind of a flavor of being more maybe international, and or the kind of thing you might find in Tokyo or something like that. And I think that's where the success comes from, largely. I think that's also producing a quality product has a big effect on it. So I think that's a very interesting observation. And I think that may be part of what allows it to be a frontier for these kind of businesses. I don't think any kind of business will succeed. And by looking around, it's really clear that any kind of business won't succeed. So it's got to really fit into this kind of niche type thing. And then I thought, you know, this issue about kind of the familial past, I don't know quite what to think about that, but I do think that in the case of Etsuko, and I think also in Hiroshi's case, you know, a lot of the connection to family has to do with the fact that they love their families, and that is a draw, you know. But then the responsibilities that go with being in that head of household, head of business kind of thing, it's hard to balance all of it. You know, I don't think in Esco's case, for example, it isn't that she doesn't want to do those things. It's just, like I said, she never sleeps. So there's just not time. And so she needs some help with that kind of thing. But, you know, I think part of the attraction for both of them was to be with their parents, whom they love very deeply. And that adds something to doing all. So I think I got all the questions.
Thank you so much.
Yeah,
they
were very interesting questions, and so I guess now we'll just open it up to general questions.
Yeah. Okay, so starting with Ellen.
Yeah, picking up on that, I think it was wonderful to hear you respond to all of those questions, because it's very helpful for me to hear what you said, and thank you so much. I really enjoyed following the stories of the folks of Hiroshi and Etsuko. Somewhere where you ended with this very interesting sense, which I feel like I've seen reflected in Aomori, of people who are coming back or making conscious choices to come back to family, to come back to region and place, and the deep-rootedness of that. A number of people I know are coming back with a similarly fine-tuned sense of what can I bring back that's going to distinguish what I'm trying to do from an entrepreneurial sense, and that those things often evoke or resonate with a broader sense of connection to the world, so pizza and gelato. And the fact that Etsuko also, if I heard you right, she studied cheesemaking in the Netherlands?
Yes.
I'll talk to you later. A student has been doing some research on women farmers in the Netherlands, and I think there are some really interesting resonances there that also come from a very kind of feminist advocacy, like, we can do this in a man's world, we can farm, don't bug us.
Well, in her case, it's and not in a man's way. That was the real thing that was interesting to me, is that she was very clear about that, is that she didn't have to live and do her business the way men do.
And what I know of the students' work in the Netherlands, I would say that it also pertains, they're very consciously describing what they're doing as, you know, we're in the same arena with men, but we're not duplicating the way they do it. But I am struck, and I'm wondering if you could reflect a little bit more on this very particular kind of expertise of bringing something back from a broader cultural repertoire, so that, indeed, I can really imagine pizza in that beautiful restored house, and his, you know, this complex collaboration with his parents, and, you know, the separation from his wife, but that wonderful kind of cultural frisson of, ooh, you know, here's this thing that has associations with a foreign place, foreignness, but eaten and consumed and socialized in this intensely beautiful Japanese space. And seems Etsuko is doing something slightly different, but still, you know, connected to the place and to a sense of expertise, local expertise in dairy farming. You know, so for even beyond the gelato and the cheese, that she's running a B&B. Obviously, her sense of, you know, decoration is, you know, wonderfully attuned to creating these small, intimate spaces within the restaurant. And the style of the house is vaguely alpine, right? So there are all these, and the cowbell, you know, all of those themes. So there's something about that. I mean, I'm thinking of historical precedents on almost an aesthetic level as well. Ukiyo-e prints that were so incredibly thoughtful about the introduction of Western stuff, right? And the combination of Western sensibilities and Japanese sensibilities remade in this new bricolage. And I'd just be interested to hear further thoughts on that, or do you know anybody else who's similarly adept at making those recombinations?
Well, I've run into several things like that, but I think we have to be careful not to over-theorize it.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he did the pizza because he likes pizza in school. I mean, that's what and you know, it wasn't out of any kind of interest in connecting to a
broader
thing.
I hear what you're saying, but on the other hand, I still think,
yes.
I think there's a question of, I don't know, what can I say? It's sort of, go on.
Well, I actually think one has to be very careful about that, because I think in the case of Hiroshi, I don't think that's in his mind. And so I think to attribute that to what he's doing would be actually a mistake.
To attribute what?
The idea that he's sort of trying to situate this in this bigger sort of cultural
consciously
thing. Yeah, he's not trying to do that. And in Etsuko's case, I mean, she's traveled a lot. She's been to Turkey and Mexico and a lot of different places. She may be more consciously trying to do that, but I suspect if I were to really ask her about that, what she would answer is that she's trying to create a place that she likes the feel of.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I certainly don't think there's a lot of conscious thinking about that going on. And I guess personally, we talked about this last night a bit.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not real comfortable with going and trying to guess what the unconscious is. I'm willing to go.
I'm not suggesting that.
I don't know that that's really there. I'm not sure. I mean, I'm not saying it's not, but I'm saying I think it could be a jump to go there. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, I'm not suggesting, just to be clear, that I'm trying to theorize the unconscious motives.
Mm-hmm.
What I am trying to understand is what seems to me a really profound sensibility about cultural combination, and that in both cases it seems to have worked pretty well, and it raises a lot of, I think, really interesting questions about the nature of social historical traditions. transformation. None of us exist in a vacuum apart from global influences. And trying to understand in these very beautifully detailed individual cases how that's negotiated, I think is worthwhile.
Yeah, I think the thing though that I guess before I'd be willing to kind of even wager a guess at any of that, I mean, I don't know, for example, that pizza is necessarily seen as foreign by people.
I agree.
And that would be an interesting question.
Yeah.
So it may not have, that may not have seemed like he was doing that to him. In Exco's case, I suspect more than anything, there were a couple of things going on that are very important. One is I think she was really trying to just create a place that she likes. And that's very important in this, because that brings in, I agree, this brings in things that are not just Japanese, but kind of from all over the mm-hmm. place. I think also she was thinking about what was south.
Absolutely.
It's really important.
Yeah.
And back south.
Yeah.
And back south really well there, because you don't find places like that so much around there.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think there was a conscious business decision in addition to a kind of aesthetic sensibility there.
I completely agree, and that's part of the complexity of the situation,
mm-hmm.
right? It's at all kinds of levels.
Ryan has a bit of
I just wonder if, on the level of analysis that you're comfortable on, would it be the same shop if he made tacos, or if he made udon, or if he makes pizza, or is that somehow a different story? Would that be a different story? And if not,
it would
that's
look
fine.
Different. I mean, I think she tried to create a shop that was how she imagines an ice cream shop. I think that's what she was trying to do. And so I think if she had chosen to do tacos, it would look
different. It'd be the same to you, though.
But,
I mean, as far as like what your concern for what she's doing, it doesn't alter that much based on what the product that they happen to be doing with this.
No, I mean, I guess what I'm trying to say more than anything is that without her consciously indicating that to me that she's trying to do that, and since I haven't asked her about that, I don't know if I don't want to take guesses, I guess is what I'm saying. I'm not quite sure what's going on in her mind in relation to that. It could be that it's this kind of thing going on, or it could be that she's just picked an aesthetic that she likes
mm-hmm.
from a smorgasbord of different aesthetics that she can pick because
uh-huh.
she is tied into the world. And she picked that one because it works well for an ice cream and cheese shop.
Okay.
And
sense.
She likes the style. I think we have to, again, from my perspective, I think it's easy to over-theorize these things. And it's really important to really focus on, person X did this because she liked it. That actually matters.
But don't you think you would be less, maybe, I mean, as you said, if you thought this was crazy, check this out.
Mm.
And that seems to indicate that you think there's something materially important about what exactly they're up to. And if that's, maybe it is just check this out, it's wild, it's neat.
It's unexpected there.
Uh-huh.
Absolutely unexpected there.
Uh-huh.
It's unexpected by Japanese people there.
Right.
I mean, you go driving across the rice paddies in western Kanagasaki, and you
mm-hmm.
don't expect to come to that building
uh-huh.
in where it is, and you don't expect it to be a cheese and ice cream shop.
Uh-huh. Uh-huh.
That is very unexpected.
Actually, I know there's an order of questions here, but I have to jump in here to say, I do expect this. The first time I visited Japan, I had a homestay in a neighborhood called Suiden Hirizu, which is a suburban development with all houses built like little Swedish chalets.
And where was this? What?
This is deep outside of Sapporo, somewhere in the big river valley there, up on a little hill, and way past rice paddies. I mean, we could walk from the bus stop across, a quarter mile or more of rice paddies up to Suiden Hirizu. So I think that the sort of bricolage that Ellen is talking about is something that I've come to expect, and that I think that probably exists on some kind of a broader scale. But I've just been terribly gauche with me because we have Professor Yamashita, and then Satsuki, and then Sharon coming up to say comments next. So.
So, in terms of distance to Tokyo, Kyushu is much farther than Tōhoku, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, I'm from the western part, I'm from Shimonoseki,
mm-hmm.
and from my view, Western view, Tokyo belongs to Tōhoku. I moved from a small city to Tokyo, I found there is a lot of Tōhoku things in Tokyo. So, but we are now discussing about Tōhoku and Tōhoku. But I can see that Kyushu Gaku. So I'm wondering what the difference Tōhoku and Kyushu. And we say Kyushu, but we do not say Seina. Actually, the west, southwest Japan is Kyushu, but we do not say Seina. But in Meiji area, there is a Seinan wall. Somewhere we drop the word Seinan in Japan, my proposal is we should compare with Tōhoku with Kyushu. That is one thing. And what was the place of regionality, personality? What's the difference between Tōhoku and Kyushu? And this is Tokyo. Imperial University was established Tokyo, then Kyoto, then Tōhoku, and Kyushu. State High School, Ichiko, Tokyo, Niko, Sendai, Sanko, Kyoto. So at the early stage of Meiji, there is something happened arranging this, regionality of Japan. That is one thing. The other thing is about tourism again. In terms of domestic tourism, Tōhoku tourism recovered 80% now. But in terms of international tourism, Tōhoku recovered just 60%. So I am wondering how is the view of Tōhoku from foreign countries? Maybe they see differently from Japanese people. So, two things, to place Tōhoku.
Well, I think the nuclear power situation is certainly contributing a lot to that, to how that area is being perceived. The one thing I thought just interesting, that the word domestic, I must admit, when the idea of domestic versus international came up, when I thought domestic, I was actually really thinking I wasn't even thinking all of Japan. I think most of the tourism is from people in the general area there, maybe other parts of Tōhoku, but I don't know how far away they really come for anything. I mean, Kanegasaki's not that interesting a place. It's not a place you would, go to unless you had a pretty good reason to know why. I mean, even the little area that, they've done this historical district, there's not much there. It's not well developed or anything like that. And in fact, if you just walked around in it not knowing what it was, you would have no idea. It just looks like a bunch of houses, some of which are old and some of which aren't. So it's not a major tourist attraction. Actually, the gelato shop is probably a bigger attraction because it's on the way to the onsen. And you get lots of people from throughout that general area taking busloads up to the onsen. And that's a stopping point along the way. And she's gotten to be quite well known in the area because of her shopping. So I think it's probably, I'm just guessing, but it probably attracts more people than the historical district does.
How old is the shop now, just
to jump in? Maybe 5 years.
But promotion of tourism may be very important to other Tokyo Olympic for international tourism. So Japan has to have strategy to promote Tōhoku in what ways? Maybe the Japan's furusato or something like that.
Which has happened before, right? The furusato.
Yeah, so the combination.
Well, again, going back to what I was saying, this is also partly a way to put the disaster in the past. you start promoting tourism, and then you try to forget about the mess that's actually still there.
Sounds good.
Yeah. Well, wonderful talk. It was very interesting, and then also I was very intrigued by all the questions that she asked and that you answered. And then from there, I was kind of thinking in relationship to earlier discussion about what Michael asked about the standardization of a memory and Ellen's in relation to Ellen's talk, and that standardization gave me the question about this whole concept of the Tōhoku is about the standardizing the region that you're asking, the very question that you're asking, what is Tōhoku, what is region, even though those people living there don't even think about in those terms. So there's something about the standardization of the region or imagination of the location that's going on. So I was wondering if you could speak to that, and also in relation to, this is something that I would be interested in further exploring in your the response, hopefully, is the your two informants. They, both of them didn't talk about in their stories in terms of Tōhoku as a region. It didn't come to any of the conversation. But I was wondering if that happened in past, because both of them were somewhere outside of the Tōhoku region in their lifetime, especially in Tokyo, or for the Etsuko's case, in Netherlands. So maybe Netherlands might be the different case, but especially when they were in Tokyo, I was wondering if they felt Tōhoku or confronted by the categorization of this standardized idea of a Tōhoku that made them uncomfortable or that contributed to their idea of going back to their own Tōhoku, that which the he or she doesn't really think of as such, but the Tōhoku became the kind of a category that they had to wrestle with when they're outside of the region that they returned to.
Yeah, that's an interesting question. I mean, I didn't ask either of them specifically about that, but I do think being from Tōhoku is kind of relational in a sense. You know, if you're in Tokyo and someone says, where are you from? You might say Tōhoku. You might say Iwate. Usually the people that I know that are from that area don't talk about the town itself, and the reason's pragmatic. Nobody's ever heard of it. So, you know, if I said, you know, I'm from Kanagasaki, you know, how many people in Japan have ever heard of Kanagasaki? So it's practical, right? You don't, there's no point in saying the name of the town because it's meaningless. So you kind of situate yourself in relation to what the other person can understand in terms of your identity in relation to the place that you're from. I'm sure, again, I haven't asked, but I'm sure if she was asked in the Netherlands, where are you from? She said Japan. And then if she got asked more, she said Northern Japan. Now, the interesting thing about the disaster is the disaster changes the meaningfulness of Tōhoku, because before the disaster, if you're outside of Japan and someone says, where are you from in Japan, you say Tōhoku, they go, I have no idea what that means. But now they do, because it got talked about in the media so much. So now it's a defined place internationally where it wasn't before. So, you know, she could answer Tōhoku now, whereas she wouldn't have been able to 15 years ago, let's say. So I think, you know, that's kind of interesting how the international media and an event like that, you know, moment changes the way people can tap into how they define themselves. But I think, you know, one of the things that's interesting is just the kind of the pragmatics of situating yourself when you're describing yourself and where you're from are often related to what you're anticipating the other person will understand. So when someone asks me where I'm from, I say I'm from Boston. Well, I'm not really from Boston, I'm from outside of Boston, but it's a small town, so what's the point in saying that? So I come off saying I'm basically a Bostonian, I'm not really. And I think that kind of thing is an interesting you know, dynamic that's going on in the way that we you know, have to strategically manipulate our identity in relation to place, in partly in terms of what we expect the interlocutor to understand. We have to construct ourselves in a way that person will understand. So you can, you know, be from Tōhoku and never mention it if you don't think the other person is going to get it, or it may be the defining feature if you think that person is going to see that as being an important feature of your identity.
So did that answer the question?
Yeah, I was interested in how you see the shift of the description of identity place and the regional identity. So, you did.
Yeah, and the other thing I guess I would add is, I mean, I know people, for example, who have moved from, say, Iwate down to their college in Tokyo, and they actively, you know, try to, for example, get rid of their accent. They try to do things to not be constructed as being from Tōhoku because it can be embarrassing.
Do either of your informants speak in the dialects, or they speak in Istanbul or Japanese?
The Etsuko increasingly speaks in dialect.
Increasingly.
Mm-hmm. And Hiroshi doesn't. He seems to speak fairly standard. But you know, then the problem I always have to respond to that is, Etsuko and I know each other very well. So she doesn't change her speech when she's talking to me much. Mm-hmm. But Hiroshi and I don't know each other that well. I would be willing to bet he's making adjustments. I'll talk to me and trying to minimize the use of local dialect, so because his assumption is I won't understand it. So it's hard for me to answer that very well because I've encountered this many times. People make major adjustments for me, despite the fact that I actually do understand a fair amount of the dialect there. The assumption is that I won't. And I mean, this gets back to, again, the same thing. They're constructing their identity in a way that I will be able to deal with, or how they perceive I will be able to deal with. In fact, in many cases, I'm fine with the fact they would have no way of knowing that. So I think that I have noticed, though, with her over the years. Yeah, I've known her a long time. She's using more and more dialogue.
So we're running a little low on time, but Sharon is next.
So I study scientists, anthropologists in history in my fields, and I'm wondering if you have heard anybody talking about this new laboratory that's being built between near Kitagami and Oshu, that's going to bring in about.
I don't know if the last I knew it had not been decided yet.
Well, the decision process, of course, is a very long one. I think
yeah.
I first visited to talk with people about this 10 years ago. But there has been a Japanese site selection, and it was between Kyushu and Iwate. So eventually, the facility. As you say, if it's built to be officially correct, would be in that area, and a lot of the data collection analysis facility will now be outside Fukuoka. So it's likely, in my experience of watching these kinds of facilities, they're almost always in rural areas. They need a lot of space, and national governments want the land to be cheap, and they want to combine it with their regional development plans. So. That's why Iwate-ken is ideal from their point of view. And I've also watched the entrepreneurship develop around these places and various around the world. And so I'm curious if you have heard people talking about all of this.
This is a big item. It's being pushed very hard by various local government organizations. There are a lot of people involved in volunteer work to try to make it happen. They see this as being central to the economy. In fact, it's on the minds of just regular people. I last summer, my wife and I went to visit a carpenter or a builder contractor about building a house. And one of the things that we were looking into is the cost of land. It's really cheap there. But he pointed out that if that happens, the land prices are going to go up because more people are going to be moving into that area. This is an enormous potential economic plus for the area from their perspective. They see it in very positive terms. And they also link it in because there's an astronomical observatory, there's a radio telescope in Oshu. And they link this in to try to frame the area as being a scientifically energetic place. It's very important in terms of trying to construct an identity of the area. and create a sense of it as a an area of important scientific research. So, yeah, it's a huge thing.
If any of the rest of you are interested, all you need to do to put into your search engine is the letters ILC and Kitakami, or ILC and Oshu. And there's all the volunteer groups, the websites,
all
everything is in Japanese, English,
yeah.
French, German, etc. Chinese,
and
Korean.
Although I have not, you know, actively been asking about this one there, I actually have not run across anyone speaking negatively about it. It may be there, but I just haven't run across it.
Can I
just ask a follow-up question? Are there environmental risks associated with this?
I would assume so.
Less than perhaps you're imagining.
Okay.
And as wherever these facilities are proposed, there are massive environmental studies done.
Yeah.
Partly, you usually narrow down to 3 sites per country, and then there's years-long studies that are done at each of the sites. Yeah. But, yeah, of course. But primarily, it's underground.
Right.
Yeah.
Michael?
I just am going to share a joke. Recently, I went to the bookstore. This is a Japanese language bookstore. And I found this book, which is entitled Inakawa Anata o Korosu, The Countryside Will Kill You. And it's written by this Akutaga Prize winner, who actually did this eye return from Tokyo to Azumi no in Nagano. It is a hilarious book. And it says something like, you know, don't think it's safe in the countryside. There are many thieves around.
What's the title again?
Inakawa Anata o Korosu. There are many thieves. You call the police, they never come. Even though they come, they have never arrested a person in Japan. So things like that. And I think you can just read it in about 30 minutes, because
mm-hmm.
it's just so fun to
me,
and just
laugh.
If I could just ask a quick question, because you gave me the idea of this Inakawa Anata o Korosu. Because John mentioned over and over again about the Etsuko or Hiroshi as you're doing something what they like. So I was wondering if you flip the question and then ask a question about what they don't like, and then how that relates to the idea of what they like means.
Mm-hmm.
And this is just a question that came up because of the Korosu.
That's a great idea. I never thought of it. That would be a really good thing to ask them. And I had never phrased a question like that way.
Maybe
I don't know, but that would be a really interesting way. Actually, even just to ask them. I mean, I have asked them on off what they don't like about what they're doing. I've never asked a general question around what sorts of things in general do you just not like, you know, in terms of career or whatever, that kind of thing. That would actually be really interesting to ask questions. So I'll try that with this.
I just have a quick thing. I was so struck also thinking about Hiroshi Etsuko that, as you very poignantly described, he's living apart from his family, but with his parents. She's living with her mother.
Her mother.
Yeah. But she's not married. And in both cases, there's been a, some transformation of ordinary expectations about kin relations. And do you have any speculations about kind of where that's going? Is that a result of the particular economic stresses in this region? Do you think that these sort of kin stressors are something new as compared to the past, or has stuff like this been going on for quite a while?
Well, in this close case, it's because she doesn't like men very much.
Right. Yeah.
You know, she's really not interested in being married.
Yeah.
She sees it as a burden and a nuisance, and just,
sure.
She's told me that point blank.
Yeah.
So that, you know, in her case, that's the motivation.
And just to follow up on that, in the context of that, she feels that she can have a life there. Which
absolutely, and that's a real attraction.
Yeah.
Is that, you know, she's really in control of at least the domain of the shop. mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. You know, other stuff related to family, less so. But that piece of it mm-hmm. is hers. Mm-hmm. And everyone sees it that way, too. I mean, nobody meddles. There's no, you know, problem with anybody trying to tell her how to run her business. She is, and I, you know, hear her name all the time when I'm out mm-hmm. doing things. She is regarded as a highly successful businesswoman mm-hmm. with a fabulous shop mm-hmm. that, you know, is just doing amazing things. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, in fact, I've asked her directly. I've asked her about, because one of the things that I've been interested in this project that I didn't get into here is that I've been interested in what kinds of impediments, particularly yeah. women who are sure. entrepreneurs in that area have. And I asked her directly, what kinds yeah. of things have gotten in the way? And she says, no, everyone's cheering me on. And then she kind of backed up and said, well, a little bit at first, there were some people saying, oh, you won't be able to do this, mm-hmm. but she just ignored them. And now, I mean, she used the word OM. She says, you know, everybody's just cheering me on, and she doesn't feel that at all. So, you know, I see her as being in a position empowered in a way she never could have been working in the world.
So interesting.
Can I just follow? I mean, that's like a really interesting yeah. question. So there's no pressure at all about, so is there, are there any children in this family? Are there any
You mean
descendants?
No.
And there's no concern about that?
Her sister has children.
One of her sisters has children.
But the sister's married, so probably.
Only yeah. one sister's married.
Oh.
But you said there are three sisters?
There's two sisters.
Two sisters.
The other one's.
Huh. Yeah, interesting.
I mean, that's really an interesting question. She doesn't, and I mean, I've asked her, she doesn't know what she'll do with the business at the point where she needs to retire.
Huh.
She'll probably try to sell it to, I think her ideal would be to train one of the women that's working for her part-time and try to sell it to one of them. She's also talked about opening up another shop and having a woman that she's trained run that shop. And so, you know, although she's not really bent on expansion and she doesn't have much time for it, I don't think there's any real concern at all about the fact that there's no successor.
And then Hiroshi, so he's living apart from his wife and one child?
Two children.
Sees only three times a year?
Yep.
And that's been going on for how many years?
Well, for like 3 or 4 years, I think.
And what do you see about, I mean, do you think that that's going to finally get so tense that he will leave or no?
Well, he says no. I mean, you know, but I've never met the wife, so I don't know what the real, all I know is his side of the story. And he plans on reuniting with his family. But if you think about it, you know, when their kids are in college, I mean, this is going to be a long time. Now, the other side of that is, that pattern is not uncommon at all in Japan. Dad's away working and
right.
mom's raising
sure,
the kids.
Right.
So
right.
that's actually right. more normal
that's right.
than
that's right.
Etsuko's
case. Yeah,
that's really
right.
kind of a, you know, I mean, it sucks for him,
right.
but it's normal.
No, that's right. No,
I mean,
right.
I have a friend in Austin
yeah.
whose wife and kids live in Tokyo.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. No, that's a good point.
Yeah.
yeah.
Yeah. But, I mean, how much his desire to be reunited with his family is just an unfulfillable dream is, I think it's really hard to say. When he said that to me, I kind of went, wow, I wonder, you know, how are you going to make that happen? I didn't want to. You know, he was already breaking up. I didn't want to.
Does he reunite with his family? Do they trip the 50-50 traveling? Or does he
no,
always?
He goes there.
He goes there.
Yeah. Yeah. See, there's something going on there. And I don't know what it is.
Yeah.
My first inclination was the Yomi thing.
Oh,
that you know, because I've heard this so many times in that area
sure.
that women do not want to live with their in-laws in that kind of situation. So my guess is that's what's going on, but there may be more going on. Now I believe she's a nurse, so she also had a career.
Oh.
And so,
yeah.
you know, that may have added to the whole
sure.
thing. Yeah. So I
yeah.
it's hard to say, you know, and of course there's only so far you can try. So, but you know, the fact that he told me all that at all was kind of amazing to me. Cause, I mean, it's a very emotional question. Very difficult.
But in a way, it's not an isolated case, right? I mean, the area which has been affected by this nuclear. There's so many families.
There's so many families. There's so many families that have
been affected. Yeah. Are so far.
Elsewhere.
And so, and for how long this is going to be?
We have just a couple of minutes, like a minute and a half left, which I will take to add some points very briefly on these issues. First of all, the sort of the international level science center, like right, the global level place of science that everyone has to rely on doing science in Iwate or in Tōhoku or in Kyushu. I think that's sort of a very fascinating question of power, and I mean political power, and sort of this sort of autonomous question. Of course, it's not controlled in Iwate, but the fact that it's there, and that it can be claimed symbolically as a sort of a world-leading thing, is a really fascinating thing to think about. Far be it for me to evaluate your work, but I'm just very impressed by it. And then there are two other things that I wanted to suggest, one of which, John, you may know very well, got her PhD at Austin, Holly D.D. Ogren.
Yeah, I was on.
Okay. Well, this is a...
So I kind of know.
That counts as knowing.
This is somebody who's been working on...
What's...
Holly D.D. Ogren, D-I-D-I-O-G-R-E-N. And she has been working on women's language and dialect. I'm sure you know a lot, but I've just been reading some of her recent work, and it's, you know, this sort of idea that women's language exists is mostly an ideology and much less a practice, much more a practice of authors and translators than it is a practice of women speaking. But then much more important locally is strategic use of dialect. In the context that make me think very much of this case of, you talk about it's called using more and more dialect, and also people are becoming more and more agreeable to her. And I wonder, you know, how is she using it in interactions to claim that kind of, you know, authority and make people and align with people? And then also, I just thought this question about moving in with your in-laws, this is something that There's a radio program out of Iwate Broadcasting, Ya Maita Maita, and it's a weekly. I mean, you may know it well. Everybody here may all be listeners, but I'll just redundantly say it's a weekly broadcast of stories of times that you got screwed over. You know, you ran out of gas or you know, something like this, and then the alternate broadcast. So that's like Tuesdays, and then the Thursday broadcast or whatever it is the Otomi no Sōdan Shitsu, so it's like an advice column.
Oh, perfect.
And it's all this like deeply cultural stuff. And so you may know very well, but I mean, if you have undergrads or a master's student struggling for a project, I mean, you know, what percentage of these are about, of these calls are about dealing with your in-laws? It's vast, some vast amount of them are that. I live with my husband's father, and he comes home and turns off the heater immediately when he gets home, and like, how do I tell him to stop? There's all these calls about these kind of things, and then negotiating the amount of money to give people as a present for a baby is born, or something. All these things, the details of it. Anyway, so I know that's not really that relevant to the overall charging topic, but it really just reminded me of that sort of kind of thing, and it exists in this radio program, so... If you want to have a laugh, please check it out. We're coming right up to the time of taking a break, and then we were going to watch/listen to this interview segment. So what I want to do is, if people have immediate comments right now, that's good, but then I want to take about 5 minutes, get some coffee. We have a plate of cookies and brownies from the same place that prepared the salads from earlier. They're very nice. So we have that, so please take something. We can say another word now if there's something pressing on your mind, but then get something and we'll sort of reconvene in about 5 minutes. Unless there's anything to, okay, all right, so we'll be back.